after TKR. So there is a need of knowing which patients should be operated and which patients should not be operated, and in which group of patients which implants should be applied. So that indications are, you all know, it's a non-infective cases, and as per my logic, the decision of total knee replacement should come from patient's end, not from the doctor's end or surgeon's end. If the patient is not motivated, if the patient has not decided for total knee replacement, then definitely post-operatively, if any shortcomings occur, the surgeon will be blamed. So it, number one, it should always be patient decision to go for knee replacement. And for the theoretical purpose, if the patient has severely restricted activities or daily living, then only the surgeon should advise for total knee replacement. These two criteria are important. So indications being, I am not going into the details, osteoarthritis, the most open face, osteoarthritis of knees being the commonest cause of indication of knee replacement, and second comes rheumatoid arthritis, and then avascular necrosis, osteonecrosis of the condyles, and sometimes man-aligned ankylosis. You know, this is man-aligned ankylosis. If the ankylosis is in the good alignment of the limb, better not to touch it, because in long term these patients are not going to be very much satisfied. And you all know the contraindications being, apart from the other factors, the thing which should be noted is there should not be any foci of distant or local infection. For that, we advise our patients regularly for dental checkup and other parts or other areas to be checked up for any possibilities of infection. And contraindications, sometimes we have to think of severe vascular diseases, especially in elderly patients, where especially in rheumatoid arthritic patients and patients having some vascular diseases. Neuropathic joints are the relative contraindications, although with the explained precautions and prognosis, we can go ahead with the neuropathic joints or Charcot joints. So which patient should be selected? There are factors that affect the success of the knee replacement and durability of the implants. These are age of the patient, activity level of the patient, medical comorbidities, and severity of the radiological arthritis or radiographic arthritis. So regarding age, it has been proved many a times by different literature that no consistent correlation has been found between the patient satisfaction level and patient's age. That means a younger patient or the older patient, it doesn't mean which group of patient you are operating, it depends on the activity level of the patient. So in younger patients, because of higher activity level and higher expectations, they tend to show lesser satisfaction level as compared to the elderly patient. In these patients, you must include in your clinical examination, if the patient is having any history of previous surgery, you must note, especially on the knee, what about the joint ROM, because after total knee replacement, you are not going to deliver more than the actual pre-operative range of movement in most of the cases. Varus and valgus band alignment should be noted meticulously, and if there is ligamentous stability and laxity, that should be noted. In young patients, UKR should be preferred. If not to be preferred in these conditions, like if the flexor contracture is more than 15 degree, valgus is more than 15 degree, and varus is more than 10 degree, and there are ligamentous deficiency, in such cases you should directly go to the total knee replacement even in young patients. And over STO in young patients, if the patient is having degenerative arthritis in other compartment like lateral compartment also or patellofemoral compartment, you should not jump upon STO. You should go for total knee replacement. Results of TKR in younger patients, even less than 55, are encouraging. And it has been shown in most of the studies, it's better than any UKR or osteotomy or STO. And good to excellent results have been found in 93 to 100, even 100% patients in some studies. And 20 years survivorship is more than 90%. So do not think that TPA is a short term relief to the patient. It's going to give the relief for more than 20 years in more than 80% of the patients. So there is no minimum age for TPA. Likewise, there is no maximum age as well. You can perform it according to the need of the patient. No correlation between age and satisfaction level. However, the younger patients tend to be less satisfied. And it can be performed in any age group if the patient is fit and able to take the major surgery. Regarding severity of osteoarthritis, one important factor in post-operative satisfaction is the level of pre-operative function loss. More is the functional loss pre-operatively, more is the level of satisfaction post-operatively. Regarding medical comorbidities, these patients, the following factors are important while you assessing the patients, like pre-operative disease status, pre-operative medical workup should be done, and in these cases, you must have a good, skillful anesthetist, because intra-operative and the post-operative complication rates are tends to be higher, and so that you have to be a good anesthetist and intensive care team to handle it later on. And the point is, all medical issues should be addressed, or rather must be addressed, before you jump upon for total knee replacement in medically unstable or medically unfit patients. For about radiographic assessment, routinely we do three views, like radiography of your knee, AP, lateral, and skyline view. Sometimes we need to go for a scanogram as well to assess the alignment of the limb and to quantify the amount of correction we need. Merchant view sometimes we need, but this is not again in the routine investigation. Regarding templating, it's important. We must learn and practice templating, but unfortunately most of us are not really very well versed with this, and it has been shown by different studies that the implant size which we measure by template is less accurate than what we measure intraoperatively. So don't worry, even if you do not do templating in routine cases, nothing to worry about, you have to be perfect intraoperatively. Other investigations you all know, but I want to highlight CRP only, because we must know the CRP level of the patient preoperatively so that we can compare postoperatively if any untoward anything happens and you are confused whether this pain and swelling is because of infection or something else. So if you have preoperative level of CRP, you can just compare your preoperative CRP level with the postoperative CRP level. Urine tests are one of the important tests. Routine investigations and culture sensitivity reports are must. I think it's must, because I have faced many patients where other reports are normal, but the urine culture sensitivity shows bacterial growth. So that may be the potential cause of post-operative infection. Regarding antibiotic protocol, it's a protocol we usually do not follow, or we usually not try to follow it, but the protocol is there. The antibiotic has no role 24 hours after the surgery. So the ideal protocol or worldwide accepted protocol is you have to give one sort of antibiotic, chosen antibiotic, within 1 hour of giving incision or making incision, and the remaining dose up to 24 hours, whatever dosing is there. The preferred antibiotic has been cefuroxime, most of us use cefuroxime, and if the patient is allergic to cefuroxime, clindamycin or vancomycin can be opted. And if the vancomycin has been opted, it should be given minimum 2 hours prior to the incision. And it should be infused completely before the tourniquet application or inflation. The important is, if the patient weight is more than 80 kg, then you have to double the dose of the antibiotic. It's an important thing. And if your surgery is beyond 2 to 4 hours, it's not specified where 3 hours or 4 hours, more than roughly 2 to 3 hours, then you have to give certain dose of antibiotic, and that must be calculated as one dose only. So regarding minimizing blood loss, in total knee replacement. So there are many agents which minimize blood loss perioperatively, intra-op and post-op, if given in adequate dosing. So there are numerous studies regarding tenecteric acid that to locally, topically, intravenously and sometimes orally. So we have available intravenous tenecteric acid and which has been recommended to give at least 3 times, mind if 3 times, single dose won't work, 3 times and preferably 2 grams each time. So we usually give 1 gram, even I use 1 gram, but going through the literature I found this, it is 2 gram which is preferable, and it do not increase any chance of thromboembolic complications. So we can safely go for 2 gram. Regarding tourniquet, there are many studies and it has been shown that there is no extra advantage of applying tourniquet. Rather, the patients who have been operated under tourniquet tend to show more post-operative pain. Otherwise, there is no much difference. So you can, it's up to you. You decide for your, according to your comfort. Suction drain, again, it has not shown any difference post-operatively. We usually afraid of collection of blood or intra-articular hematoma and further which may lead to infection. But in many studies, it has been conclusively proved that there is no increased chance of infection even if you do not use drain, post-operative drain. Regarding materials, we all know it's a standard knee, all poly monoblock. I am not going to do the details. Gold knee is coming up. It's important in some group of patients who may have allergy to the metals. So gold knee is not for everyone. It's not a fancy thing. It's for the patients who have known allergy to metals. And that gold knee has slightly lesser incidence of post-operative allergy complications.
On this time, always right time, right?
So counseling, you all know, it should be one-to-one responsibility with the patient and the relatives, and the chances of deep vein thrombosis, deep infection should be explained. The last issue is obesity. Should be operated in morbidly obese patient and patient with having BMI of more 20 to 30. Yes, in patients with BMI 25 to 30, the knee replacement.